No, I like the idea. But what I do is, let me step back.
But, I mean, just to kind of what you just said, it's like two and kick right there.
So
you gotta train like some of the right stuff, so whatever you learn in the beginning is not definitely not the whole thing. I understand what you're saying.
I mean, that was here's the main is three primary reasons why. Okay, first, for me. Yeah. First, I respect it because I know the historical roots. To the practice which became known as the Zebra Dance. That's where it came from. That's the mark. There's nothing wrong with the posture and technique. The issue becomes how functional you train. That's the issue. I use that technique all day. I just don't do it like that.
Not losing the context.
Not using the context.
Why you're doing that.
But if you change the laws, and then you, first of all, you check, you lie about the history. Most of the brothers and sisters practices wasn't in the cities in the first place. They actually live free all the time, or they bounce into the country the next time to a Christ unit. But you have to speak Dutch. You have to speak and read Dutch. You have to speak and read Spanish in order to read their history to realize, oh, that happened. You know, right? You have to read, you have to be part of Hawaiian, right? And in the Triple Alliance War to know, oh, so that's what happened. You know? But because the Brazilians ain't giving it up.
Can you imagine if everybody knew that people was out there, you know, fighting for their freedom successfully?
Come on.
Yeah, some successful freedom fighters.
Come on.
Oh, really?
Is that it? Dude,
oh, really?
Now?
They can do it. We can do it.
Literally our own. Another thing I say is very important. The system is our direct. It's just like the parallel analogy I use is, with all respect, let's just say it's a Korean guy, right? Dude's born and raised in California. Speak about that much Korean, like when he says Korean, that's it, you know, right? But at any point in time, you know, right? But at any point in time in his life, he can turn around and claim the entire fighting system legacy of Korea as his, whose blood and culture he's right. But the split second we try it.
Oh, no.
You hear me? Nah. All right? You know, and you got a problem with it. Read your history. You don't get mad at me.
Well, I mean, but you know, that's part of the problem, though, is that the history is hidden.
That's what I mean.
Right?
Well, you know, that again is part of our thing. To me, that is part of the problem, but to me, that puts more of the onus on us. We know that's the problem. All right?
Well,
so it's on us.
Not everybody. We do.
No, yes.
But not everybody.
Yes, we do.
Right.
And it's on us to pull that out and disseminate that. Otherwise, we deserve whatever the consequences and ramifications are. You know, so that's what I do. And that's what a lot of people think didn't matter about me.
Now, come on now.
Talk to me.
The reason people are angry is because you're making it sound like what they're doing is inconsequential.
What I said was what they're doing is cardio capoeira. It's not inconsequential. It's just not something.
Right. But
which
you understand.
Much,
you know it's semantics.
No, well,
some people will interpret it
yes, but.
But you being a PhD, you need. Obviously,
aspirant,
I
ain't gotta get
it.
You gotta get it.
You gotta put the work in.
Yeah.
But, you know, the onus is on you to know that this is the interpretation people are gonna have when you call it.
I'm aware of that.
Right?
I'm aware of that. So when you read my post, I say it. Listen, if I say cardio, if you are not practicing self defense, let's look at it from a bare bones application, straightforward, functional way. You do the same, let's call that negative, right? You do the same one, but you don't know you're supposed to fight with it. You take the context out. And you do it, and you do it, and you do it. You don't know why you're doing it, but you know when you do it, you get in shape. And then that becomes your reason to do it. Is that the reason why the technique was created? Are you able to apply the technique in the way that Ogun would do it? Can you apply the way the Shango could do it? You know, because you don't even know who they are. Do you know, can you do it the way Osho could do it? Can you do it the way Eshu could do it? Do you know who they are? Do you know why it's important to do it?
Right. Well, I mean,
this is what I'm talking about.
But I understand what you're saying, but well, you can take any martial art. And the first moves that you learn, you're not going to know what it's for.
Well, no, I disagree. I disagree.
Or you won't understand the complete context.
No one can understand the complete context because you can always learn.
Because on any technique,
yes, sir.
Once you reach a mastership, you're going to know at least a minimum of 10 different ways to get into it, 10 different ways to get out of it.
Correct.
10 different places to apply it.
Yes.
You're going to know the intricacies of if you move this move like 1 centimeter or 1 millimeter. To the side, so like you were saying, the negative in and of itself isn't anything. And as a beginner, you're just doing it because somebody told you to do it.
Right, right.
But like you were saying, the onus is on the teacher to eventually make that reveal, or even better, if the student figures it out on their own, then you know you got a good student.
You know what? As a matter of fact, let me address those because you just touched on something that's uniquely African. The second thing that you just said right there. But let me go back to the beginning. All right, the conversation in comparison with other fighting systems. The first thing I disagree with right away from that assertion is when you teach your other fighting systems, you know that you're supposed to fight with. That's the message. No one tells you that you learn karate to make friends and to dance and to be in shape and to learn culture. You know, that's not what you do. When you're trying to reverse and point somebody in their abdomen, when you're trying to run and kick somebody in their head, all right, you will not go over there and be like, you know what, if you learn this kata, you get the culture. No. That's not what your parents are putting you in. That's not what you're looking for. If you're going to boxing, you're not trying to appreciate, you know, the diversity and the multi-tier levels of the culture of boxing. How sweet the bags look hanging up, and how dope it is to get your jump over. That's not what you're doing, all right? Now these cats are selling this as a core reason to practice.
Well, I got a counter to that.
Talk to me.
I got a counter to that.
Talk.
Because the difference from what I've read so far is that the way the communities usually maintained is through events where people would gather around. You know, maybe it was solstice or harvest or coming of age. So you had reasons to come together. So community was just as important a part of some of these martial demos because now you get in the middle of the whole community and it's coming of age. Then you go up against some of the other people, and then all the ladies are like, "Well, he's the best one. He's the best one." So there is a community aspect that we have in this that does not exist in jiu-jitsu. It does not exist in karate. It does not exist in taekwondo. It does not exist in almost any other art around here. Even in Kali, I think Kali was the closest thing I found to that, where there's a lot of tradition and there's music along that goes along with the movements. You know, you got so you had that, but still that's not as much community oriented as capoeira. So there's a community aspect, and it's part of the nation building, and that's the part of capoeira that we need more than anything else, is getting people together and getting people to, you know, collectively be in the same place at the same time so that we can have these discussions.
You know what? First, let me say I respect that position that you just put up. You know, I do respect it, and I agree with about 75%. But I do not think that's what we need to do more. I think that the mistake is made that we emphasize one thing more than the other. This is a massive mistake. If you train only for fighting, who you may suck as a person, you may be a well-trained bully. All right? Yeah. If you train sweet with the culture, dude, you got zero squabs, and that's not going to help you. Now, we have already learned a lesson with Black Wall Street, with Palomares, with Teresa de Benguela. We can go back over at Spartacus, learn the lesson. All right? If you don't have the squabs, people who have zero morality will roll you over. So then you have to ask yourself, why would people get together in numbers to get rolled over by people who would not be able to get a bad scout? See, so we have to be aware of that. What takes us right back again to that core information that we need to learn, our history, our language, our culture, and that we as teachers need to disseminate as a whole. If you miss any part of it, you miss it. You know, it's not that I can't, you know, it's not that if we're going through and we're doing, you know, any of the things, it's not that I can't do it. It's that I can fight while I'm doing it. I can show you the fighting aspects of all that, and I can show you the cultural aspects of it, and give you some of the primary African terms and terminology we're using in history. But that's what makes the difference.
And I definitely appreciate that, because you do need somebody out there who's saying, look, we're going to be in here. If you're going to, this mestre in here, the mestre tend to talk about this all the time. Not every mestre is not going to know everything. One mestre is going to know music. One mestre, they're going to know the movement. One mestre is going to know the language. One mestre is going to know the history. One mestre is going to know the people. You're going to have a network.
Yes.
And so you have to, have that community so that you can find out who's going to teach what. If you're going to have, one mestre,
mm-hmm.
who's going to know how to, look, this is how you apply it. So we're going to have, if you want to be a warrior, a true warrior, you go to this team. If you want to learn about the history so you can disseminate that to the youth in the future, go to this guy. If you want to understand the music and understand how music can move people and motivate people to do things that we need them to do, then you go learn from this team. So it's never like, if we had everybody doing the same, there's one story about a yogi. Did you see the one where he was talking about?
Yeah.
When the Indian dudes was like, you want us all to be.
Hold on, tell the story for the folks who don't know. Yes.
You gotta have some variety.
Well, what you're talking about is the necessity of not being homogenous, having multiple diversity. Skills and diversity. And I agree with that. The 18
you're saying it's too much.
What I'm saying is that there should be a distinct, let me back up, let me make it simple, right? You can't find an elite boxing coach on earth who can't teach you how to box. They know the history too. Now, some boxing coaches will know it better than others. Floyd Sr. will teach you the intricacies and ins and outs of boxing, what have you, and they teach you some specific things about boxing history that say somebody else won't. Freddie Roach will say something that somebody else wants. You will say something that I want. I'll say something that you want. But you know what? You can fight. I can fight. You can teach somebody boxing. If the core aspect, the unavoidable core requirement to being even proficient in a self-defense system is that you are proficient in self-defense. You have nothing to teach if you're not proficient in self-defense. Even the music is rooted in self-defense. And then once you're alive enough and not sweated enough by the enemies, then you can engage in other aspects because you're not busy being dead.
Well, I don't think we're saying anything different.
Yes.
Because I think what, to me, it's more, a lot of it is on the student. Because the student comes in wanting to learn, but they're going to have their own direction. Mm-hmm. One of the things that Mestre used to say is like when Mestre Christian would teach his students, all of his students would look different.
Yes.
Nobody would play the same exact way. And that's because everybody comes in with their own set of skills. Some of them might want to be able to fight better than you.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're learning from a Mestre who's trying to teach you to fight, it's really important that you understand other fighting techniques. Because he's only going to be able to teach you how to fight in his style. He's not going to be able to teach you. He should be telling you, look, you need to understand somebody's going to come in and do something that I haven't taught you to defend. So it might be smart of you to go look at what other people are doing. Go to open mats or go to open holders and see what other people are doing. But have this as your foundation so at the very least you understand this. And I feel what you're saying in that while he's teaching, he still needs to explain the importance of the martial aspect of learning.
Yes, sir. This is from
that
otherwise
is,
you won't be alive enough to learn anything else.
Right.
And again, I'm not trying to interrupt with you at all because I really enjoy this exchange and this interview. But it's whenever we're talking about issues about African-oriented Manchu fighting systems, then and only then suddenly it becomes magically important to talk about something else that's not that is proven to be deleterious, to be harmful to us. If you're coming to learn swimming, let me explain it to you. If you're not coming to learn swimming, that coach does not tell you, I can teach you underwater boxing. After you get good at swimming and holding your breath, you may then learn to be able to manipulate the aspects of breathing, spinning, what have you, pull yourself underwater, and then apply to other skills. But you learn to swim first. If you have, we all have different stuff. My brother holding the camera right here, he fights differently than I do. But you know what? You can fight. You fight differently than I do. You know what? You can fight. These differences cows are really at root. I'm about to get a little bit more hippie and then make somebody mad. You know, right? But the different styles, all right, are really the result of politicization of what was once a comprehensive approach of self-defense. There was no separation. You know, now, there may be people, I'll give you a perfect example. He's boxing. Floyd Mayweather doesn't box like Tyson, who doesn't box like Ali, who doesn't box like, you know, they're all boxers, though. Now, they may have a particular way in which they express the fundamentals. They may have a particular way in which they have a delivery system. They have the fundamentals. They get those very, very well. Then once you're skilled with that, you then add your personal expression upon the fundamentals and the delivery systems. That gives you a personal style. And so once you get your personal style, that, you know, you then, of course, you tailor it to your personal idiosyncrasies and your strengths and cover your weaknesses, as it were, or strengthen your weaknesses to the point, you know, where they're not so much weaknesses using your skills, da 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 da. That's why Floyd does what he does, which in Africa, one of the terms for that is being gallows, being tortoise, you know, because you're holding the shield, you have experience, you know. That's why Ali does what he does, why Tyson does what he does. But the thing you will find, if you ask all of them, throw an uppercut, they'll throw. Throw a hook, they'll throw. Throw a jab, they'll throw. They show you stance to do it, they'll pivot, they throw. In cardio capoeira, that does not happen. You come here and say, okay, you know what, show me the, what's one of the more common things that's done in what it was? Shuffle, okay. Show me the shuffle. How would you use the shuffle to a clinch? Or how would you do a shuffle if somebody attacked you from behind? Well, you know, the reason why we're asking this is because we already have the historical answers. Our ancestors did that. Shuffle, one more time. Shuffle. Cool, okay. Now, how would you get from a clinch? Somebody's clinching you. How would you do that? From a alright, I'm gonna do the same way you do it. You're right hand or left hand. You're right.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna do the same technique, right? All right. What I'm gonna do here is now I'm gonna break the knee up and then drag the knee, give you a special groin, give you the kick. You see? Shopper. Alright.
But that's not a shopper.
Yes, it is.
That's a knee.
No, it's not. It is, you have to chamber your knees, throw the shopper, you extend your foot out, throw the shopper. You use the movement, you just weaponize it.
Okay.
From here.
So first you say you raise the knee.
Boom, right here. See, that's right here. See my foot? Can you see it? I'm going to put my hands here. Right here, boom. I kick at the top. You then step one of them out here. Boom. See that? Yeah, all of that is there. That's also from that part. You know, you can, then start showing the differences. Like a ocean, water, river. You can feel the difference. The ocean does it. Yeah, same thing. Yeah, the ocean is way less water. It feels like what? Ocean. All right? You can do it from standing all the way down to the ground. Same thing with a guy, it'll be like earth. Stance is a way more solid move. Because if it's a dream, you're looking at strength and power, metal, you're the same with boom. Same thing. But without that knowledge, without the application of earth, that's where the core of the knowledge comes from. It's also the foundation for the spirituality. If you take the spirituality away, from this application, what you have is basically flowering philosophy without any real world value.
Right. Okay. Well, I think the boxing analogy is incomplete to some degree. And the reason I say that is going back to community and being able to empower everybody in the community.
Yes, sir.
Boxers, generally speaking, don't end up at the top of the food chain financially. So when you're fighting,
you mean that? Are you talking about like in all forms of training, or are you talking about sports?
I'm talking about specifically. We're talking about boxing.
Yes,
sir. Talked about Muhammad Ali.
Yes, sir.
And, you know, Joe Frazier, whoever.
Actually,
you know, you get a handful of people who make it to the top.
Not just the top, but literally the great.
And even those people who make it to the top, Mike Tyson, even the ones that make it to the top don't stay there because the discipline. With the fighting, as important as that is, mm-hmm. you still need to be able to the ability to be able to fight mentally in other platforms.
Yes,
so that's when you start talking about the music and the community and the network and understanding the power of finance. You know, it has to be collective. So once you start to focus it,
on the martial aspect, that's great because he needs some work. But when that boxer goes in and he knows how to do an uppercut and a hook because his teacher taught him how to do that, that's fine and well, but who's going to teach him how to manage his money? Who's going to teach MC Hammer, now he knows how to dance, he knows how to rap, who's going to teach him to manage his money? Who's going to teach him to build the network that he needs to be able to make everybody else around him survive? And to me, that's what our version of Copway is. We learn the martial aspect.
Mm-hmm. I like what you showed me. It's a different way of looking at that shop. Which is, and we go through that. We never discuss it that way. But I really like the way you presented it. But we talk about that. You know, that it's important to understand all the different aspects.
But let me engage that because there's a constant incorrect assumption that I'm not looking at that. First, let me go back to the boxing. The number one in the history of the world example of that, who's also the number one financial mogul of theirs, Floyd Money Mayweather.
Okay.
All right, the first in history to go over $1 billion. He is an example on a world level of exactly what I'm talking about. And there's a difference between, by the way, that's a warrior. What a lot of people are talking about is because they don't understand the distinction between a soldier and a warrior. A soldier is someone who can fight and follows orders. A warrior is someone who can fight for a reason, has a code of honor, understands the history, the things that we're talking about, all right? And that connects to the history, that connects to the community. The assumption is, because I'm looking at these cats who can't fight and are not fighting and are not defending anything, and not only that, they're contributing to the dissolution of the art and the separation of the art and the loss of the art from the African people who created it and the monetizing it. I said that of it, you know, right? Okay. These cats got zero squabbles. And what's I don't care about that. But worse so is that we don't have the squabbles. And now, again, I am not bad mouthing community. Without community, I wouldn't be here. You wouldn't be here. My brother wouldn't be here. My father wouldn't be here. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is because we have the community, in order to eat, an inescapable reality of that community is that we have to fight to save our life. That we had to do that first. And without that, and if Foster's fighting that way, you also have to know what you need to do to build the community. Otherwise, once you stop fighting the community, of course. This is the reality that a lot of people are making a mistake. They're making logical fallacies.
Right? I'm sorry, man.
So, and this is one of the things that we discuss online. I say it all the time. Dude, that's cardio capoeira. Our ancestors did not speak Portuguese. Don't talk to me about that. You know, well, then who are you? Who's your message? Well, my lineage comes from Congo. 4,000 years older than Europe. All right? If anything, we asking about primacy years, you need to prove yourself to me. I'm granddad. You know, right?
Yeah.
You know?
Romelo was saying, he was saying back in Africa, the folks who are out here came from a much older lineage.
Yes, sir.
And so when you go back, you have this whole new generation that don't remember.
Yes.
And he just came back from Kenya.
Yeah, that's my point. And you can find aspects of it in Kenya, in Nigeria. You know, I mean, right now, I got your call this morning. You know who I'm talking to on WhatsApp. I'm not going to tell you what you said, all right? I almost said it. I'm not going to do that. All right, my bad. You know, right? Okay, so, all right. but that's my point. I'm not denigrating anyone by pointing out what is obvious.
But you understand how people interpret
this. You know what? If I say 2 + 2 = 4 and you get mad, bruh, you know, right? And I walk you through the process. Here's two. This is the process of addition. It equals the exact quantity of 4. And you get mad. Your math sucks, bro. That's just what it is. You know what? Right?
Oh, see, you asked the wrong person that question because it really depends on the year. I'm not gonna
the exact quantity, not the unspecified. I'm talking about the exact quantity of 2.
Right, I know, but
let's not do that. All right.
We're about to go down the whole thing. I was on Quora
debating 2 plus 2 equals 4 and why in what situation would 2 plus 2 not be?
You get lucky,
it's because
I'm sorry. It's because of the youth. What are you adding? If you're adding a pregnant woman into the equation, that's one of the units. When you ask how many people are coming, people are coming, is that 1.5?
I'm saying, exactly. You know, and when does it become due? Right?
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, it depends on the units, but right.
We're talking about, you're correct. I agree with you there. I actually had an argument, a debate about that with my teacher when I was in the 9th grade, keeping out of class. You know, right?
You got to keep your mind open. I feel what you're saying. Because there's a lot of people that, like you said, they aren't teaching with the purpose of creating. That's not the purpose of why they're teaching. But some people are. There are people, and it really takes time to get around and understand people to find out who's who. Because to our earlier points, once you find out, once an enemy finds out who the person is disseminating this information, then it would be to their advantage to get rid of that person.
Of course.
So you can't just go out and tell everybody. You don't pick your students after you first meet them. You don't pick your top students, the ones you got to share all the, give all the gems to, just because they paying you money.
Of course.
Right?
Of course.
But you can create an environment that gets more people in, so now you can filter. Oh, there we go. Let me give him the seeds.
Mm-hmm.
Let me give her the seeds.
Yes,
let me explain this to people. And so there's different approaches.
Different approaches.
And I feel because what you're saying isn't different than many other martial arts, where you have masters who are saying, well, you're denigrating art, whether it's karate or kung fu. You're denigrating the art by introducing people and monetizing it so that you can get, giving people belts and stuff so that you can make money in that way. And it's not new. I understand totally what you're saying. All I'm saying is that you understand that some people, even though it's 2 plus 2 is 4, God damn it. Why you tell me that? You know that's not the case. I don't want to hear that.
I understand.
That's my only point.
Well, let me say it like this. I've heard that argument for 27 years, right? And my response is, well, let's go and take a reasonable look at the particular argument. Because in some areas, I'm not saying that. Other areas, I'm actually saying something that's even more farther off, right? Right? First of all, I'm a teacher here, and the enemy is about, and the enemy sees me teaching, the enemy would have the reason to come and fall, right, and take me out. I actually agree with that under certain circumstances, but these are not the circumstances, right? And to compound that, brother, let me get all the way straight right here, because I know you vibing here, you understand what I'm saying? All that argument to me vanished insofar as any form of justification is concerned. Before the civil rights movement. I'm talking about those of us who are alive now. We got to my grandfather, my grandfather didn't make the argument. He was doing what we do now, and that's how I got born in the first place, right? But we're looking at Otis Brown. We're looking at all of those horrible events that just made it to the news, and we're from the hood, okay? We know that for everyone that comes on TV, there's 1,000 that don't. We know about it because it's here. Now what's happening here is that our people. I'm sorry, mister.
Oh no, you're doing an interview?
Right. Yes, sir. Just the person interacting with you and stuff.
Oh, okay.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry, is that okay?
I was just trying to figure out what was happening. It seems like y'all getting ready to do something on YouTube, but I just want to make sure that the editor, since he's editing the film. Who are you anyway?
I'm Anthony, that's my brother.
Oh, that's your brother?
That's my brother.
Okay, so you must be the oldest one.
Yes, I am.
Oh, yeah? Oh, yeah?
He got the height, the good looks, and the intelligence. I'm just, I'm just short and rascal.
Oh, man.
Right?
That sounds like something very personal. I'm going to tell your mother.
There's just not enough positive. Just.
Oh, I'm going to guess. We're discussing here is on family art. Which is our family.
I don't know anything about controversy.
Good.
No, what I'm saying that, I mean, you know, everybody has something to share, something like that. But I'm always, whatever you're sharing, always tell people you've got to be really clear about what you're sharing these days.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. That's the most important thing. So if a lot of people have some really good things, but the material is not consistent with the dialogue.
Yes, sir.
So it's important. I mean, you know, not just because I'm a capoeira teacher, but also because I've been teaching other things for years.
Yes, sir.
So I work around. I met some of the greatest professors that's part of the United States. I either work with them directly or indirectly. A lot of them passed on, you know. So in terms of that, you know, just talking to John G. Jackson, Dr. A.C. Hilliard, those guys are deep in STEM into their research. So when they say something, they know they can back it up.
Yes, sir.
But they don't create conflict in it. Controversy is only in the minds of the person who don't know.
Yes, sir.
Okay. But we also got to communicate to each other, talk about stuff. So I talked to other people from Angola about the old art forms from Angola. Brother lives in, he's not here probably now, but you know, they came here in 66, right? So people know about their own traditions and art in Africa. Only a few of them decide to embrace it.
Yes, sir.
You know, because of neo-colonialism, slavery.
Yes, sir.
And you get brainwashed.
Yes,
so, but I don't want us as a community to get brainwashed ourselves.
Absolutely.
You know, so
absolutely.
So it won't be a conflict. So what do you do? We validate what you do just as much as the other person.
Yes, sir.
Right. So, but there's a lot of things that sometimes old teachers I met don't teach everything.
Of course.
Okay.
Of course.
Yeah, but what you see on one page is not always on the back page.
Oh, I understand.
I've experienced that myself.
You know, and then I just simply ask another question, or in the process of the dialogue, the question becomes asked, and the answer either comes or doesn't, or you don't want to do, you know, that. You know, so in general, what I've been stating is there's, especially since 1964, the fighting system, or the self-defense systems, the human development system of Florida, coming from the residue, has been focused primarily on the commercial, the monetary, the non-self-defense, the cardio,
and then you got to qualify that.
Let me say
which ethnic group you're talking about.
Okay.
Say that.
Okay. What I'm saying is, I'm not talking about an ethnic group in specific.
No,
I'm talking
but
about the general approach. Let me get exact. I'm saying the art as it has been spread amongst the rest of the world from Brazil,
right,
has been oriented, focused more toward culture, fitness, pretty much anything except for African and self-defense together, and along with the notion that the art was created in Brazil in an attempt to co-opt that which is African, in an attempt to justify the fact that even today, if you add all the ethnicities up, who teach the art, 8 out of 10 are not black.
No, that's true.
So, you know, that, you know, to me, I've had people say, oh, you're racist for saying that. I'm like, no, look, think about this. How many high-ranking Wushu Kung Fu instructors are not Chinese? How many high-ranking Taekwondo instructors? I mean, the high-ranking, not the fourth. I'm talking like the high-ranking, the big bosses are not Korean, instead of so on and so forth. Oh, you don't have a problem with that. The moment I say this about Africa, you have a problem with that. I don't think the problem is with me. The problem is with you.
Well, it could be the problem with you, but you got to understand there is a conscious state. Brazil is 20 years behind.
Yes, sir.
Compared to the United States with a progressive movement.
Yes.
So, I don't, you know, at this stage of my life, I don't have conversations like that with people. I mean,
yes,
I think that's for the generation. You guys, that's great. I mean, you know, I don't do those conversations. Because what I begin to look at is that, it's for me, that's a distraction.
Yes, sir.
Because when you're going through it, you don't need to go back to it.
Yes, sir.
So what you need to do is move forward.
Amen.
So now everybody's going to understand that. There's a very few people, even here, as well as in Brazil, understand that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Those of us who do understand it because we came through the 50s and 60s.
Mm-hmm.
With a different kind of political mindset. So all the guys I know who was aware of traditional arts, even my dance teacher Malanga from the Congo, they come from different professions because we're all from the same generation. Yes, sir. So we don't argue or discuss that. We may have a discussion with a white person from Brazil or some white person from France who's learning calculator. We might say, well, what do you think it is? And then we kind of look at each other and laugh. And
yeah.
I'm not going to spend energy on that because they're not the center of a universe. Mm-hmm. And when we keep making them the center of the universe, you're distracted from the realities and where you need to be going.
I completely 100% agree with you. Let me add a little more context. The only reason why we're even talking about this area.
Yeah, but go ahead.
The only reason why we're even talking about this area at all is because we were addressing the collective ad hoc. You know, and ad hominem, you know, responses that my posts and my videos have generated from me and the people here. And it's not so much, my uncle is from the same generation as yours. Mm-hmm. He said almost the same thing you did, almost verbatim. All right.
I had that conversation with people. I'm from Texas.
Which is why the majority of the time I'm not discussing this area.
Right.
The majority of the time I'm just, when we discuss, I haven't had the honor to, you know, now. Mm-hmm. But when I discuss with anyone who's around my age or even senior, you know, right? We're talking about the application history. Da, da, da. We already get that. We already got the squads. Now the problem has been that the majority of the dissemination of art since 1964, way before I was born, all right? The idea has been capoeira is to make friends and it's Brazilian and no, it's not. Stop lying. Tell the truth, all right?
No,
and that's where it comes from. Yeah.
But the argument, that debate, I mean, to be honest with you, that was the thing that people in Brazil in the 20s, 30s knew that. So they knew, because remember, everybody before it became sanctioned as a school in the late 30s, pretty much it was only in the neighborhood. You know, your father taught you, maybe your uncle taught you, maybe the grandfather, your godfather, you know, maybe your mom might know a couple of moves.
Yes.
Show your kids. Well, this is what your daddy used to do. Yeah. Right? So it was organic, you know, just like traditional belief systems were organic. And now you have a common belief house, and now you have a capoeira school. None of that stuff exists until the 1930s. Right. Other than that, you learn stuff at home, just like when you learn, my father played piano.
Yes, sir.
Well, most people didn't go to, if your father learned piano, you didn't need to go to piano school.
Nope.
Sometimes you learn from your dad osmosis. He'd be playing, and you just pick it up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like some people just pick it up, and they got a good ear. They may not end up playing piano, but they'll play another instrument.
Yes, sir.
You know,
yes, sir.
That's how comfortable it was, even in there. And it wasn't a Brazilian art form until the 30s.
Yes, sir. And that's another issue that, for some reason, is like, well, actually, not some reason. I say some reason, I am deliberately being sarcastic. All right? Okay. We know the reason why that's been the case.
Yes.
It is because, let me say it again, it is because the sisters and brothers who were practicing art were not the ones that were highly successful, were not the ones who were compelled to live in the city. They had lived on their own in freedom, in their own quilombos, and they also broke the boundaries of Brazil and spilled over to other countries where they established their own independence. And that's how Brazil kept finding itself in conflict with with various other European colonial powers. Who were like, dude, we can't even control your Negroes and pigs spilling over here, you know, into my country and your neighbors, you know, where they could be, oh my God, I forgot it. What is the Dutch colony right next to Brazil? Come on.
Paraguay.
No, that's the Spanish. The Dutch one.
Ghana?
No, that's the other one, the Spanish too. You know, the Dutch one, man. Remy Bonjansky's, you know, and his squad's from there. Come on, man. Going there, you know, to come to me in a minute. You know, those cats who get mad, the Dutch wanted to go to war with them. That's how they want to try to invade, you know, Brazil. Same thing with Paraguay, same way. That's what happened.
Right. Paraguay is part of that way. So
So
what I translated to, I translated what they said in Portuguese was Paranaway, which is Paraguay.
Yes.
Yeah, which was where the Dutch and the guys, and they was having a war. And then they used slaves, so-called black folks, to fight in the war for freedom.
Yes, sir.
Not expecting you to get
to freedom. Not to survive.
But you survived. So then they had
to become. I'm so glad you said that, Mr. Kimba, right?
Yeah, that's what they said. Okay.
See, guys, now, so y'all can't get mad at me, all right? This man right here, who's like more senior than you and your teacher, too, he knows. So, all right.
I'm going to think about it.
All right.